Howdy folks, I'm going to explain how this antique Frigidaire temperature control works. This fridge is somewhere in the late 1920s. I've been told 1927 to 29 is when this model was made. And it is in very good condition. Even still got the labels in it. And this tray we actually have, I just don't have it installed. I don't think that's original, but it fits in there. So this thing, it was originally a sulfur dioxide system. You can see the evaporator had a float inside here that is responsible for metering the refrigerant. But again, the temperature control is quite interesting. This knob here is connected by these two cables to this wheel. There's a little sprocket wheel behind there you can see. And when you turn the knob, those cables pull the chain. Another thing you'll notice right in there is the electrical contacts. They're open right now because I have it in off. And this arm is lifting the pin up and it's forcing it to the off position. So this doesn't actually directly sense the temperature of the refrigerator. What it's doing, this bellows piece is connected by a line here into the compressor's suction port, and then this tube back here is going all the way up to the evaporator, and that's coming in through this fitting, and it's sensing the pressure inside this evaporator chamber. And since the refrigerant gas has a known property of a certain temperature for a certain pressure, as long as we know the pressure, we know the temperature, assuming the system is working properly. So when you turn the control down colder, a little spring touches here to adjust the temperature setting. So when the temperature in the evaporator rises up, it causes the refrigerant liquid in there to boil and produce a higher pressure on the low pressure side of the system. And that higher pressure is pushing up on this bellows and pushing up on the beam. So if you want to make the system think that it's really warmer than it actually is, it pushes up on that pin with a spring, just a little bias pressure on it. The harder it pushes up on that, the more the compressor is going to run to draw this bellows back down to reach equilibrium state. So even though it's not sensing temperature directly, it is doing it through the refrigerant pressure in the low pressure side. Now this thing has a repulsion induction motor. You can see the commutator in there. It uses the brushes on the commutator to start itself up. And then once it's running, it runs like an induction motor. And then the compressor you see back there is a single cylinder open drive with a belt on it to drive it. So I'm going to turn it on. Now it hasn't been run and the system is hot, so there's a lot of pressure on the low pressure side. That's going to put a lot of stress on the compressor, so it may, the belt may slip a little bit at first, and but once it pulls down the temperature, it'll calm down. So I'm going to turn this knob. Just going to pull these cables and turn that little sprocket, and that lever will move out of the way and let the contacts close. So here goes nothing, going for a start. See the contacts moving together. Now the motor's running. I'm turning that toward the colder side, making that little spring touch the pin like that. Now as I keep turning it, it's putting more pressure on it and forcing the control to run a lower refrigerant pressure in here, therefore a colder temperature. And we'll let it run, and it's going to pull the cabinet temperature down now. One thing about these belt drive units, since it is a mechanical device, there's going to be some vibration. Now the furniture dolly doesn't help, but that's one of the things where the newer ones are better. But that's already getting cold. You can see the sweating on it. It's probably more than 90 degrees in here, so it's having to work hard. And these cooling fins here get cold from the evaporator and then cool the whole fridge off. So when I turn this knob here, those two cables are turning a little sprocket. And when the sprocket turns, these flooded evaporator systems, this thing has got so much refrigerant liquid in it that sometimes it boils like with a pop or a thump to it. It sounds kind of like when you drop water into hot cooking grease. And the way it was explained to me, these were designed for an oil and a refrigerant that don't blend together. So the oil floats in a layer on top of that. And the position of the float inside here is such that the oil will float up and go down the return line back to the compressor without a lot of liquid refrigerant flowing back. But because you have a non-mixed oil with refrigerant in there that aren't mixed and they're in layers, sometimes you get that same popping, thumping sound that you get with water falling into hot oil. And that's getting close. It's almost going to start freezing that water bead on there. That little sound it's making, the tinking sound, that goes away once it's pulled down all the way. So I'm going to close the door and let it run. Late 1920s Frigidaire. A lot of mechanical parts. It's very, very intricate. And the ones with the sealed compressor like we use today are a lot more reliable, a lot less to go wrong. But for someone like myself who's fascinated by machinery and loves antique stuff, this is something that's worth keeping going. That single cylinder compressor turning at a low speed right now with a lot of pressure on it, it's working hard, it's got a rhythm to it. Once the low side pressure gets lower due to the cold temperature, once it's really cycling normally, there's not as much mass flow through the compressor, so it doesn't have as much of a compression stroke to it, and there's a lot less of that. You can see now the sight glass is clear, because when that refrigerant is warm enough on the high side, the oil will kind of blend with it a little bit. You don't get a film of oil in there. And this is running refrigerant R152A. Well, she's been running about 10 more minutes. Getting nice and cold in there. All right, it's been running maybe 5 minutes. Look in here and you can see it's just starting to frost up in certain places. Probably hear the refrigerant boiling in there. Getting some pretty good frost in there. Down and shut off the contacts right in there open. Well, it just cycled off. You can see this lever is dropped below the roller. Now the contacts are open. Gradually the pressure will rise back up and it'll trip back on. Take it a few moments. Been a few minutes yet. Still waiting on it to get ready to trip back on. The pressure out of the low side just draws back down, it'll cycle off again. You gotta love that propulsion induction start sound. Looks like the pressure-based temperature control and its chain drive system are working properly. Turn it down colder. Now that little lever will pop up in a second and start it back up. As soon as it rolls over that little cam rolls over the follower, it'll start. All right, so that's going to be it for the pressure-based cold control video. Hope y'all have enjoyed it. Get to take a look at this piece of engineering from a long time ago. It still does its job today, just like it did when it was new. Catch you later.